Then there is the other piece of the question, which is like the referring process. And here I have to say that, I mean, there are many people, you talk to people, you're an editor, so people talk to you, and every person have a view of what the process is. And the fact is that, I guess, talking to other editors and myself into different journals, referring process is not a very well-defined object. It's the idea of consulting other people to get their opinions, but then how exactly to do this? You know, how formal versus informal is it? How much to weight their opinions? Do you just kind of a machine that basically collect yes, no decisions from four other people and then aggregate them and have like a cutoff that like at least two need to be yes before you accept a paper? This is a process. I think very few editors, if any, is actually applying such a process. Most editors are basically reading what the referees have to say, might give them a call once they have something to say that you want to kind of follow up on, might put them on the phone with other referees to kind of discuss if there is a particular kind of sticky point. But exactly the way you aggregate the different ideas that you got and how much you use your own vision or your own sort of view of what's a good paper and what's a good reason to take a paper and why I should not take a paper. It's very idiosyncratic to a particular editor. So the whole concept of the referring process, I think, is a little bit kind of wrong in the sense that like each one is going to come up with his own kind of idiosyncratic process by which he or she is going to aggregate different opinions. And the final part of this question, like broken, I think to me, broken means like not working and cannot be repaired. And I just here I fairly strongly feel, as I said in the first answer, that like no way this is the case. Of course, kind of everything can, you know, you can use tweaks and improvements. It's always useful to start engaging and thinking about if we had to tweak some stuff, what would we tweak and how exactly and would it work and what even it means for something to work or not. To me, kind of at least that's my own perspective, it feels like sort of things are kind of roughly kind of all right and you know, always we should try to make them better, but nothing is broken really. Having 5 more minutes, let me just say, like, if I had to kind of pick up, just to raise stuff for discussion, I'm sure some version of this is going to come up later. If I had to pick 2 issues that kind of bother me as an editor that I wish there was a way to kind of make things somewhat better, one is timeliness. I think, I mean, people here probably have better data than I do. I think things are getting better relative to 10 years ago, but still, I mean, you know, sometimes things take forever, and that's kind of bad for everybody. people have this view, referees are awful. That's why, or editors are awful. They're sitting on a paper for 3 months. I think just my own kind of experience is like 90% of people, referees, editors are great. They're doing their job right on time, everything is fine. There's a little bit of a tail of sort of refereeing that sort of require more hand-holding, and often this is what's causing the delays. Most editors kind of know who is going to be the referee who is going to require more hand-holding than the others, so these are not some sort of you discover as you go. I think for the most part, you had enough experience, you're going to figure out kind of who is going to be requiring kind of more nagging and more stuff. And to be honest, my own perspective is like if there was one piece of the job of an editor that I would be happily outsource is going to be the nagging referees and making them kind of, you know, respond faster. I mean, some editors kind of outsource this part of the job by not doing it. And that a lot of often is what's causing the big delays, because if you decide, I don't want to nag anyone, I just want them to do whatever they do in whenever they can do it, you know, sometimes you're going to sit on a paper for 9 months. If you end up kind of nagging people, that's kind of not pleasant. It's a bit like a beggar, because you cannot pay them back in any particular way, so you just ask them and ask them again, but sometimes that's the only way to go, and that's, it's difficult to outsource, because most referees wouldn't respond to kind of some admin stuff or some automated email, kind of, they really require sort of the personal part. And I think the key issues on this is just we don't have too many carrots and basically no sticks to give kind of good or bad referees. So we must rely on goodwill, and it would be nice to sort of think about systems. These are like, you know, pay them more. I think some journals are thinking about paying more referees, or we can have shame list where all journals collect sort of names of really badly performing referees, put them somewhere in a possible way, and then maybe kind of the fear of being on the shame list is going to kind of cut off sort of the tail of really long kind of responses. But I'm not totally sure that the particular people who are slow are going to be the one who are going to be the fastest to respond to this type of thing. But that's for sure the one item that would be nice to kind of get faster. The other point that I think, again, it's another one that if we had a time series, I think it's getting better, but is the point about late round rejections. For sure, as an author, I had this, I think, three times in my career that I got kind of rejections in later rounds. That's awful. It's just awful because a lot of the revision part is basically responding to particular idiosyncratic kind of comments from particular referees on an editor. If it doesn't, if it converts, great, we don't mind to do this, but if it doesn't convert, we just wasted 6 months of work, almost for no reason, or for reasons that basically would get deleted in some future revision in some journal that will later accept the paper. So it would be nice to move to a system that basically editors commit to decisions faster, much earlier in the process. One, it would make it much more pleasant to do the revision when you don't have the cloud of uncertainty around you. And second, it would avoid kind of all the inefficiency. Probably we shouldn't aim for 100%, that would be crazy, but sort of something like 90% or 95% eventual acceptance of RNRs would be nice. It would require editors to set a higher bar for RNRs and may force referees to take more of a role of a yes-no assessment rather than like, you know, anonymous co-author. It might also make authors kind of submit papers that are closer to the final version. Right now, what you see is quite often you get submissions that are basically, here's an idea, here's what I can do with it, tell me how to go forward. So basically, and partly I don't blame the author, it's like an endogenous response to kind of the process. So if we can make the process more of a yes, no, up and down kind of decision, that would be nice. Preston did something, I'm sure he's going to talk about it. He did something in Economic Inquiry where he had like the no revision policy. Not sure if it worked well or not. For sure it worked a little bit. But maybe that's too extreme. But one other idea I would throw in there is maybe something that's being done in a medical journal that you have like a limited time on turnaround of revision, like 60 days or 90 days. What it means, one, author cannot kind of do too much stuff, but also when referees and editors know that sort of an R&R means like a 60-day turnaround, you cannot ask them to write a new paper because like nothing can happen in 60 days, so that would limit the scope of a revision and essentially would mechanically force everything to be much closer to an up and down. So that's something we could explain it, we could think about, and again, you know, none of these things, every paper is different, and for sure any rule should have some exceptions allowed. So just final thoughts. I don't really, the way I think about it is like really no right or wrong editorial decision in many, many cases. Like a lot of cases are kind of in the gray areas that they can either get in or out. But and the preface requires many judgment calls that are kind of by definition subjective. But for the most part, as far as I can tell, people are trying to do the best to kind of make decision or recommendation in the most professional manner. So all this complaining about this guy is bad and this guy is in the club, this guy is not in the club, these are all maybe like one story for each complaint that is true, but there are like 99 stories that are just not true. So I think it's better for everybody to just trust the system. I think for the most part it's working. Just write good papers and pray or hope for kind of some good results. Thank you.
Thanks very much, Liran. Our next panelist speaking is Glenn Ellison.
Okay, thank you very much. Thank you, David, for putting together this panel. Let me say, on the basic question, is it broken? You know, I think my view is there are some systematic problems with the publishing process, but many of the issues are issues at individual journals. I think in some ways this is an unfortunate panel that David put together in that, you know, David's basically put together a panel of most of my favorite journal editors and I think that the journal editors have a great deal of power to not have things be broken at their journal. And so in some sense, this is something you have to draw a distinction of, you know, which are the problems that exist everywhere and which are problems that exist at some journals. So anyway, you know, I thought I'd start with, what is it that we want journals to do? I think the biggest thing we want journals to do these days is to certify the quality of papers. This is important for many different reasons. You know, all of us need to figure out which papers we're going to read. We can't read everything that gets written every year. Many readers also are not very sophisticated in judge who want to like get the conclusions of economics papers, who can't assess the sort of methodology themselves. We want to give readers a sign that this paper has or does not have trustworthy conclusions. And then also, you know, journals are very big in the evaluation process. We use them to decide who to hire, we use them to decide who to promote, we use them to decide who to fund. All of those sort of funding agencies, you know, and promotions, you need to be promoting people who you're not an expert, and we need the journals to do that role for us. Journals can also provide an incentive to do high quality research. I would say the sort of biggest thing offsetting that, and where I think that many that I sometimes see problems, are in the minimizing the cost of the profession of having a review process. You know, if I think about it, if I ask myself, how much time do I spend on original research versus all of the things that go into publishing papers that I'm doing to publish them, not to do the research, I spend much more time on publishing than I do on research itself, which suggests to me that that's a huge cost to the profession, and I think that's what we should be thinking about here. How well are journals doing? You know, it's interesting that there isn't so much research on this issue. On the certifying paper quality, it's hard to say like whether journals are actually picking out the best papers. You know, there was sort of a recent paper by Ivo Welch that sort of noted that referee recommendations only seem to be fairly weakly correlated, and this is true both like, you know, in one finance conference, but also looking at the referees' reports submitted to many of the top economics and finance journals. If you just look at correlation of referee A with referee B's recommendation, they're not highly correlated. Now, does that mean the editors don't use that information to pick out the best papers? That we don't know. I would say one piece of evidence I have on the pro side is, you know, one of my papers I published with Preston's No Revision Option in Economic Inquiry notes that, you know, if you actually look at citations to a paper, they're highly correlated with where the paper is in the journal issue. So the eighth best paper is getting 25% fewer citations than the third listed paper. You know, that would seem to indicate that the editors, to the extent that they're ordering the papers on quality, have some notion of the relative quality of the papers they've just accepted. You would think if you have a notion of the relative quality of the papers you've just accepted, the ones you've just accepted are better than the ones you've rejected, and that's sort of some sign that there is ability there. And then what I think I'm going to spend most of my time today is what do we know about minimizing costs on the profession? You know, so pair of 2002 papers in the JPE noted that there's been this big slowdown in the profession over the last 30 years, roughly from 1970 to 2000 when I wrote the paper. Much of this is tied up with the growth of revisions, and I always think the history is interesting here because the history, I think, shows you that there is an alternate universe out there where things don't have to work the way they do, and we can think about whether we like the way they work now versus the way they worked in that alternate universe. So I'll just start with a couple sort of historical anecdotes. First, you know, I was talking to Richard Caves about this once, and Richard mentioned to me that he just sort of thought it was humorous when he saw CV and it listed paper, revise and resubmit at the JPE as if this was the greatest thing in the world that you have this revise and resubmit. And he said, you know, when I was young, never would I put a revise and resubmit on my CV, because I would have been incredibly embarrassed that I had submitted a flawed paper that had to be fixed, and it would be something you would try to hide that you had gotten to revise and resubmit. My statistic that goes along with this is not just Richard's memory, this is number four. The number four is the number of revise and resubmit requests that Econometrica made in the year 1959. So the entire year the journal asked for four revise and resubmits. Their policy was, if it was wrong, we'll ask you for a revise and resubmit, otherwise we'll take the paper. Here's a case study also I put together, Samuelson 1960 versus my most recent publication. Here's the decision letter on Paul Samuelson's paper. It's not one of his best, but it's handwritten. It says, you probably can't read this very well, your paper on the St. Petersburg Paradox has been refereed and accepted for the first issue of IER. I enclose the paper and comments to the referee. Will you study the comments, make appropriate revisions? So even when papers were accepted, there was this revise and resubmit stage in 1959. Here was his referee report. He got one referee report, two main comments, and a bunch of small points. You'll notice, though, even the second main comment was the last paragraph of the appendix and the last paragraph of the footnote four should be put together and separated from the rest of that footnote, which deals with a different matter. And then he has the minor comments, which are before size of the stake, insert the word constant, replace it can be shown by it will be shown below, and things like of that nature. Anyway, you know, this letter was sent to Paul August 31st, 1959 by U.S. mail, presumably not FedEx or email. That was a Monday. It probably arrived on the Wednesday. On Friday, Paul sent his final version back to the journal. Says, there it is. I've done what you asked. I put a new page called 4A because I didn't want to bother retyping that explains something new. Here's my paper. For comparison, just here's my most recent submission. I think this is the first round decisions, and actually I have to thank Penny, who was the editor on this paper. You know, you'll notice that, you know, what is Penny dealing with there? And she has a very hard job. It's 18 pages of referees' comments, and then she's got to write 4 pages to describe which of the 18 pages of comments. You know, this is in some sense my model of what good editing has to be today is take these things that are being written for you with 18 pages of comments and tell the author which of these 18 pages of things do you need to do and not do, and then work from there. But obviously, it's different from this report. So slowdown, you know, here was the color figure I had for my 2002 paper showing that journals sort of had gone from 6 to 9 months to publish papers up to 18 months, up to 2.5 years in the Review of Economic Studies case, which was the green line. I didn't have time to fully update it to today, but anyway, here are sort of some things of what's happened since my paper. I think there has been a much bigger recognition in the profession that we don't want to keep doing revision after revision after revision after revision, and journals have tried to be faster. You'll notice the AER, which had been up at the sort of 24-month range right in 2000, is now running around the 18, 19-month range. Econometrica had been 2 years, and it looks like it's still just about where it was 15 years ago. Review of Economic Studies also, which was the worst and still is the worst, is sort of running at like 26 months to get a paper published. Some comments on this is, I do see this as a norm. You know, I argued in my first paper, I think it's a social norm, not something that's caused by change in the profession. And I think there's a lot of evidence that that's true. You know, my experience at Econometrica was everybody wanted to cut down on unnecessary revisions and excessive revisions, but just everyone had a different view of what was excessive. So, you know, in my case, I rarely sent revisions to referees. I accepted 74% of first revisions. My co-editors pretty much sent all their revisions to referees, and they accepted 30% of first revisions. Currently, Econometrica is very proud of cutting back on revisions. Their summary editorial statements tout that they accept 75% of second revisions today. Recent paper we were sent by Craig Holden noted that there is striking difference of different norms in finance, that the JFE, the mean submit accept time is 10 months, Journal of Finance's submit accept time is 27 months. It's hard to imagine those two journals work in completely different professions, and it's not sort of an arbitrary decision that journals are making of which process do they want to have. And the AEA side, I'd say the AEJ applied, which you know Penny and Laurent were partly responsible for, has done a phenomenal job of being a really fast journal. They're running at 10 months. Other AEJs are running at 12 to 15 months. One thing you can hope is that journals like that can provide competition for the rest of the profession. Something that has not improved since I wrote my paper, another trend I noted in 2000 was that papers had been getting longer and longer and longer and longer. I took this figure from a Card Della Vigna paper, and you'll notice that it just shows the black line on there. Papers just keep getting longer and longer and longer. That trend has no break whatsoever in 2000. This is going on. You know, my view is that in part, this is not, papers aren't don't have to be fundamentally different from what they were 10 years ago or 20 years ago. But in part, this is that the referees are demanding a lot of things. You put a whole bunch of stuff in the paper to satisfy potential referee criticisms, and then the papers sort of grow for that reason. Will competition discipline journals? One thing I would note is a trend I didn't notice in 2000 because it didn't exist then, but has happened since, is that you might have thought that people would just not put up with this sort of long delays at some journals, but in fact, you know, look at the line on there in the bottom for Review of Economic Studies. Submissions to the top general interest journals have just skyrocketed in the last 15 years. The top line there shows that roughly it's gone from 3,000 submissions to 5,500 submissions a year. If you ask me sort of what's the biggest problem journals have, I think many of the things like the reviews, good editors can deal with that. This is sort of a more fundamental problem to the profession that I think we need to think about dealing with is, you know, people want to be in top general interest journals. They keep submitting them to top general interest journals. The AER has actually responded to this by greatly expanding the number of papers it publishes per year. All the other top journals have not. And so what's happened is acceptance rates have plummeted. In 1980, the mean acceptance rate at a top 5 journal was 18%. Now it's 6%. And I see this as the biggest challenge now because you know, if you run a profession where journals have 6% acceptance rates, if every journal does that, you've got to submit your papers to 17 different journals before it gets accepted. You're using 30-plus referee reports. you're using lots and lots of editors' times, and I think that's sort of a big difficulty we have is, do we want to have this system where you submit your paper and, you know, what I'm saying, you get a bad report, you write over and over again, I don't like econometric review, I go to the JPE, I go to the AER, then I go to the AEJ, but this sort of multiple submissions, I think, is a real problem for our profession and something we'd like to do. This thing the AEA could have addressed with the AEJs, you know, but AEJs could have filled several holes in the profession. The hole they decided to fill was for a second tier of just below general interest journals. And so, like, as submissions have grown there, like, as AEJ applied has gone from 300 submissions or 200 submissions to 500, they've still just taken 40 papers a year, and they've said they're going to entirely move up on the quality of papers, not on the trying to sort of get this mass of papers through our publication process. And I think that's something we have to come up with a solution to, is how do we get all these good papers out there published without sort of having to spend so much time on fine-grained quality decisions that are going to make us sort of have everything refereed 15 or 20 times. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Glenn. Our next panelist speaking will be Penny Goldberg.
Hi, so in contrast to Liran and Glenn, I don't have slides. I find it very hard to summarize all issues journals face these days in 10 minutes, but I will try to make some general points, and then I can provide more information in the question and answer part of the session. First, you know, let me start by making, you know, a very simple statement that seems obvious. There is enormous heterogeneity across journals and also across papers. So part of the reason it's so hard to answer the question that David put for this session or talk about journals in general is the experience varies depending on what journal you submit to these days and also on what kind of paper you have written. So with that in mind, I will try to make some general points about the refereeing process that I think apply to journals in general. So the first one is, in order to answer the question of what the refereeing process should be like, we should have a view of what journals are supposed to accomplish, what are the goals that journals are supposed to achieve. And I think reasonable people can have very different views on this topic. I will tell you what my view is. I think the most important function that journals have these days is certification of quality. And the second one is they play a very important role in promotions, especially promotion to tenure. So with regards to the first one, certification of quality, in the old days, journals were viewed as a means of disseminating ideas. I think that doesn't apply any longer. That's partly because of the emergence of the internet. It's very easy for people to post new papers on their websites. There are blogs, there are working paper series, there are conferences. So it's much easier for someone who has a good idea to disseminate it. On the other hand, precisely because there is so much information out there, people want to know which of these ideas have been vetted, which ideas are robust, which ideas the profession at large accepts as being valid. And you know, this demand for certification of quality is actually greater among people outside economics. So when journalists read our journals, when people outside economics, policymakers, pick up the journals, they don't want to know what the exciting directions for further research are. They want to know what's right and what's wrong. And that puts an enormous burden on the journals. So when you accept a paper, you don't just indicate what you view as an exciting area for research. You also indicate what conclusions you viewed as valid. That is particularly important when the topic is policy relevant. So if you think about questions such as the effects of the stimulus package, you know, debt relief, healthcare reform, minimum wage, there people really want to know what a journal like the AER or the JPE or Econometrica view as a valid conclusion and what they view as a not valid conclusion. So this brings me, you know, to the implications of this demand for quality for the refereeing process. The implication is you want the refereeing process to be very thorough. Thoroughness takes time. You want the best people, the experts, to review the paper. Sometimes you have to ask for multiple rounds. Why? Because even though you believe the result that it's in a very exciting paper and you're inclined to accept the paper, you also want to make sure that the result is going to survive various robustness checks. Because if it doesn't, just as many authors are going to scream at us because we put them, you know, through 10,000 hoops, there are many people who actually look at economics and they say, this is not a science. You publish a paper in the AER and 1 month later the result is proven wrong. So this demand for quality calls often for a rather long and very thorough refereeing process. On the other hand, as I said before, there is, whether we want it or not, journals play a very important role in promotions. And you know, this is not something we put on our front page as being the primary function of journals, but de facto, we all know that this is the case. And this calls for quick turnaround, for efficient turnaround, for making a decision early, and for making sure that you don't destroy the careers of young, talented people. I have to say, as an editor, I take this very seriously. I think a field is only as good as the people who are in the field. And if in the process of vetting the best ideas and the best papers, we drive the best people out of the field simply because they don't have the endurance to go through 3 or 4 rounds of reviews, then as a profession, we lose. My bottom line is that as an editor, especially, you know, as an editor of the top 5 journals, you try to strike a compromise between these two demands, which have opposite implications for at least the length of the refereeing process and the number of reviews, and strike a balance. And with that in mind, if you ask me if the review process is broken, I would say no, I don't think it's broken. I actually think it works quite well these days. At least I would make the statement it works much better than in the past. I graduated in the 90s. There, you know, the typical experience was you would submit a paper to a journal, you would have to wait for a year to get a response. And if you were lucky, it was a revise and resubmit. I think this does not happen anymore. Many of the processes have improved. That said, I still think there are problems and there is room for improvement. I think this often doesn't show in general statistics. If you ask me about the statistics at the AER, they look great right now. 90% of the papers, their fate is decided within the first 5 months. Almost all of them are decided by 6 months. What I still worry about is the tail. There are still a few papers out there which take a very long time, and these are usually the papers that are serious, very serious, and worthy of consideration, and then the editors take a very long time to make a decision. So I do worry about these tails, and these are often, you know, missed in when people focus on means and medians. I think there is room for improvement there. That said, I also have to say that whenever you hear these horror stories about very bad experiences people had at various journals, sometimes, just to give the other side of the story, sometimes people had this experience precisely because the editor was trying to give the paper a chance. The default decision is to reject. If you reject, you don't go through this process of agonizing about what to do with the referee reports, you know, how to ask the author to revise the paper, and so on. Rejection is, you know, a default that might make the all sides happier. But sometimes editors don't do it precisely because they're trying to help a paper. If, you know, in the end they end up rejecting, then they look bad, and then, you know, many, many times I've actually personally have regretted doing that. So let me finish by actually listing a number of challenges that from an editorial point of view, I think they're quite important these days. What are the challenges we face? So number one, I think one of the main challenges in almost all journals is the increase in quantity. At the AER, I used to receive 25 papers per week. Now it's 45, sometimes 50 per week. And many of them are actually good papers. Why? It's, as Glenn said, because people submit to various journals again and again, but it's also because we live in a global world, and now we get submissions from China, from Asia, from South America, from Africa, from all over the world. That has imposed a very high burden on editors and referees. So there are simply not enough good people to referee papers. Second, the quick turnaround has resulted in shifting the refereeing process from senior people with tenure to junior people. Personally, I never use graduate students. I know other editors do, but I do use assistant professors. And I think we need to think about what this implies for the quality of papers we publish. I'm sure that many of you, when you submit a paper, you would like a senior person with tenure, with a lot of experience to review your paper. The chances of this happening are very slim, mainly because most tenured people don't referee anymore. So you rely more and more on assistant professors. Their technical comments are superb, but a person 1 year out of graduate school doesn't have the perspective of someone who's been out of graduate school 10 or 20 years. So I think there is a loss for the profession there. And it gets worse by all this pressure to have quick turnaround. Tenured senior people are not going to respond fast. And finally, let me finish with what I consider to be the biggest challenge, which is that the production function in economics, the production function for writing papers, has changed. There are many complaints, and Glenn mentioned some of them, about the length of the papers, and I sympathize with many of them, having also been on the other side of the process and being asked to do more and more in order to publish a paper. That said, today, speaking of empirical work, a typical empirical paper is an empirical project that has two or three co-authors. The people have worked on this project for 3 or 4 years, if not more. They have used multiple data sets, some of them confidential, from multiple countries. And then they put this all together in a paper that's actually impossible to write. I sympathize with the authors there. So just describing one of the data sets they use would be a paper by itself. And then you ask a referee, who's someone who knows the area, but has not worked that closely to the topic, because if they're too close, usually they have a conflict of interest. Then you ask them to comment on this project that five good people have worked on for 5 years. The referee is overwhelmed. What is the referee supposed to do, and how are the authors supposed to write the paper? So one proposal I've put on the table, and there was no enthusiasm for that, but I still think it's a good idea, was to do what the scientists do, write summaries of these projects that are 15 pages long with many pointers to appendices, where people actually explain in great detail what they did, and knowledgeable referees can actually look at that. That said, you know, that brings up another challenge, that all these huge projects that are out there, that referees actually can hardly judge, also would call for a replicability of results, and replicability is an issue as more and more data become confidential. So I will stop because my time is out. Thank you, David. But I just want to make this very simple point that this change in the production function has brought up many new challenges, and the answers are not always simple and are not always easy. And I think just saying, put limits on the papers, make them shorter, is not going to easily solve the problem.
Thank you very much, Penny. And now we'll take my turn. So I'm going to talk about cosmetic surgery. So this is what I call cosmetic surgery in the review process that is, and publication process that is, compulsory embellishment of papers, and whether that's a good or a bad thing. So Glenn has talked about the strong trend in economics toward greater revisions, greater embellishments, so I need to skip forward. There's also the question of why that has been occurring. And Glenn, in an empirical paper, explored various possible explanations, and the evidence provides very little support for most of the explanations that one might immediately think of. And so then why has this happened? And Glenn has a theory paper, which he was too modest to emphasize, I guess, which is a model of evolving social norms in the review process, where there are two aspects of paper quality. One aspect, Q, is the inherent quality of the main idea, and then the other R is the quality of things that are improvable by revision, such as robustness, exposition, and so on. And the model implies that the weight on the revisable characteristic rises over time, though there's no implication in the model about whether that's a good or a bad thing. More recently, Matt Spiegel, a former executive editor of the Review of Financial Studies, published an editorial which was a call to arms, arguing that review is excessive, and he basically calls for an up or down review process, as was close to the case in the past. But to conclude about whether the review process is excessive, we need a theory of how the process works. And so I offer a very little model in which is based on conflict of interest between referees and editors that leads to forced embellishment. And basically it's because of information problems that cause editors to demand low value revisions. Basic problem is the incentive of referees to build reputation with editors. So reviewers are trying to demonstrate their high quality to editors, and in particular, they're recommending the repair of things that are mere blemishes. But the editors, in their invincible ignorance, can't distinguish a mere blemish from a serious flaw. And so the editors tend to think that a reviewer who identifies something to be repaired is smart, even though the editor is rational. And even when actually it's just a mere blemish. So this creates signal jamming incentives on the part of referees, and the editors end up acceding to cosmetic surgery. So what's going on in the model, it focuses on a promising paper that should be published, and the only uncertainty is whether repair is needed before publication. The paper can have a flaw or no flaw with some probabilities, and the social value of publishing the paper as is negative if the paper is flawed, it needs repair, and is positive if the paper has no flaw. And the author can repair the flaw at a cost that's less than one. So the paper always has a blemish, but to the generalist editor, a blemish looks just like a flaw. So it's socially optimal to publish even a blemished paper. Actually, every paper is blemished as is, as long as there's no flaw. So the players in this game are the author, who is passive but has payoffs that are part of social welfare. Namely, it's costly when the author has to incur a cost C to repair the paper. The referee can be a high type or a low type with 50-50 probability, and the probability that the referee observes a given flaw, given that that flaw is present, is greater for the high-type referee than for the low-type referee. And referees would like to be viewed as the high-type referee, if possible. Now, the probability of observing some particular blemish, and there always is such a blemish, is Q, and that's independent of whether there's a flaw. So if the referee only observes a flaw, then the referee will report a flaw to the editor. And if the referee observes only a blemish, the referee can report no flaw, but the referee can also falsely report that that blemish is a flaw. And so the referee's goal is to maximize the editor's perception of the referee's ability, so maximize over the report the probability that the referee is high from the perspective of the editor, given the report. So the editors, being saints, even though they're ignorant, they're saints, they maximize social welfare. So the welfare is just the... The welfare, if the paper is published as is plus one if the paper has no flaw, minus one if the paper is flawed, and the welfare, if a revision is required, is one minus the cost of repairing the revision. So if one can impose parameter constraints to get an equilibrium where if no flaw is reported, then the editor publishes the paper as is, and because no flaw being reported is suggestive of no flaw, though it doesn't prove it. And if a flaw is reported, which is suggestive of a flaw, then the editor insists on repair. So in this equilibrium, the referee always reports a flaw whenever the referee can. That is, whenever the referee has discovered either a flaw or a blemish. And so this is the signal jamming that the referee is reporting flaws too much. Then rationally, the editor updates favorably about the referee when the referee reports a flaw. And the reason is that the high-type referee is more likely than the L-type referee to detect a flaw, and therefore the referee, being a high-type, is able to report a flaw more often overall. So whenever a flaw is reported, we have dysfunctional cosmetic surgery. So this is suggesting that the referee process works quite imperfectly. Glenn has mentioned this evidence, which is not directly tied to the model of low correlation of referee recommendations, which also suggests a very imperfect referee process. Now, the model is consistent with greater cosmetic surgery in the finance field, because over the last half century in finance, there's been a rapid expansion of the number of people actively doing modern research, extremely rapid growth of technical development in the field, which is harder for editors to evaluate, increases in number of submissions. So these changes suggest in the model more cosmetic surgery, because with many people in the field, there's less prior information that the editor has about the scholarly ability of referees, and therefore there's more incentives for referees to try to build reputation with editors through signal jamming. And there's also less ability of editors to directly monitor flaws versus blemishes with the technical development of the field. On the other hand, the model does not explain the more general slowdown in economics, which Glenn has discussed. So that suggests that one needs Glenn's model, where culture migrates and evolves over time, so that there are multiple equilibria, and there's a gradual shift in time toward equilibria that have greater embellishment of papers. Now, in Glenn's model, the reason that you get that migration of the culture is because of author overconfidence. My cosmetic surgery model suggests that conflict of interest and signal jamming incentives might also play a role in shifting the culture over time. A further thing that the model suggests is that there's a social value to active editing. So one point of view is that editors, being ignorant generalists, that like Britain's House of Peers, they should restrain the itch to interfere in matters which they do not understand. One of my favorite songs. But in the model, if there's some probability R that the editor can directly observe whether the reported flaw is actually a blemish, if we set R close to zero just so that we don't need to analyze a different equilibrium, now if the editor figures out that the reported flaw is actually just a blemish, then the editor should say, ignore the referee, I'm publishing the paper. So that creates a social benefit to active editing. One other variation is that suppose there's a small probability that the given blemish or flaw cannot be fixed. Then in the case where the referee claims that a blemish is actually a flaw, in equilibrium the editor insists that this be repaired, and so a good paper dies. And so this is another social cost of the signal jamming incentives. And going slightly beyond the model, we'd expect this to be especially important for innovative papers if innovative papers are hard to get perfect without any minor blemish. One last consequence of signal jamming that I'll mention is that outside the model is that if there's a lot of compulsory embellishment, that can affect not just who verifies the result. It affects not just whether someone verifies a result, but who verifies the result. So authors have an incentive to, when they're doing robustness checks, to confirm their paper's conclusions. They can almost always find a way to do it. Now, if there's requirements of extensive cosmetic surgery and many rounds of revision, then that delays the publication of corrective papers. And that, in turn, means that editors and reviewers start worrying greatly about publishing a paper that has any error in it. And so you get a self-feeding process that requires more and more revisions, but these robustness checks are done by the author instead of what might be more accurate of robustness checks by somebody else. So policy, to close with policy recommendations, one is to sanction signal jamming. So when an editor catches reviewers reporting blemishes as flaws, that's not always an innocent mistake, and therefore the editor should be tough about that. Second, don't demand low-value changes. So editors should not hesitate to overrule reviewer requests. Referees should reduce the demand for low-value revisions as a precondition for acceptance. It's fine to suggest improvements, but not if they're low value, not to insist for publication. And Jonathan Burke, Cam Harvey, and I have written a guide on preparing a referee report, which makes this comment and has other suggestions for refereeing. As has been mentioned, journals do indeed differ greatly in their demands for revision, as Glenn and as a paper by Craig Holden has documented. Then cultural and organizational changes. My editorial that I've talked about suggests some changes in journal organizational structures that might help a bit on reducing cosmetic surgery. But my main comment is that we need to change the culture, that reviewers and editors need to be aware of this problem, and then we can consciously and publicly coordinate to do a shift in the equilibrium. So thank you very much, and with that, I'd like to turn this over to our next speaker, Preston McAfee.
Thank you, David, and thank you for organizing this session. Let me start by saying I'm not making an official Microsoft statement here. As far as I know, Microsoft has no position on whether the refereeing process is broken in economics. But in any case, this is my personal opinion. So let me start by talking a little bit about what's going on with economic inquiry. Actually, very much motivated by Glenn's 2002 paper, I launched an experiment at economic inquiry where you could opt to submit a paper under no revisions. And what that meant exactly was the letter that came back would say yes or no. We either accepted the paper or we rejected it, but there would be no required revisions for that paper. About a third of the authors in the first year opted for that, and the success rate of those papers was approximately a third better than the regular submissions. Let me also say, when I became the editor of Economic Inquiry, it was that year it got 214 submissions, and this year it got 616 submissions. So in one sense, something has been a dramatic success in that the submission rate has almost tripled over the last 8 years. There was a lot of discussion at the time whether it was possible to commit to the no revisions policy, and I think at 8 years and counting, I'm comfortable in saying, yes, it was pretty easy to commit. You just never asked for a revision when the author opted for the no revisions policy. Sometimes that meant rejecting papers that were fixable, and required major fixes. And sometimes that meant accepting some flaws or blemishes. And one thing was the fact that the authors weren't required to revise didn't mean they weren't allowed to revise. And at least during my time at Economic Inquiry, I'm comfortable saying that 100% of authors revised their papers in light of the referee's comments. Now, that doesn't mean they took every referee's comment, and I'm sure everyone in the audience has experienced the case where one reviewer said, take out section 2 and emphasize section 3, and the other said the reverse. So sometimes the reviewer's comments aren't even pairwise consistent. A lot of my motivation for the no revisions option was that in my own personal experience, I think the first revision of my paper is the best. But on average, they get 3 revisions, and they're going downhill. And in fact, most of my econometrica papers are worse than the initial submissions, and the strong exception to that was the one that Glenn accepted, where he accepted it with one round of revision, and that was at its peak. Currently, Economic Inquiry gets only about 15% of its submissions under no revisions, but they do about one-third better. That is, their acceptance rate is about one-third higher than the regular submissions continues to hold and has the whole time. So, and so, by the way, give it a try. It's an experiment. It's an option. If you've got a paper, you know what you want to say and you know how to say it, this is a pretty nice option because it'll either get accepted or rejected. They take a little bit longer than the regular papers. Last year, that was 67 days versus 65 days to the first response. So not only is it no revisions, but it's quick. Okay, no one has mentioned any other fields. Economics is really extreme. We have the longest time to publication of all major disciplines, and by far. Everyone I talk to in other fields is just shocked at how long it takes us to get a paper in print. So that is initial submission, and by that I mean the first submission. So I want to take into account Glenn's 17 rounds, which is probably the pessimistic view. Some of those papers are abandoned earlier than that. But the fact that they go through multiple rounds, papers in economics can easily be 8 or 10 years old before they finally show up in a journal. And that's a shocking thing to basically every other field. I've been voting with my feet, so I'm going to spend my remaining minutes talking about what's going on with computer science, because most of my publications over the last 8 years have been not in economics journals, but in computer science conferences. So the first thing to understand is that computer scientists mostly publish in conferences. They don't publish in journals. And so our tendency of saying that conference publications are garbage, and if you want evidence of that, look at the AEA. Again, not official Microsoft statement, doesn't have an opinion about the AEA proceedings. Our bias against conferences is not only not shared by CS, this is where CS, most computer science publications appear, are in conferences. These run on a cycle, most of them on an annual cycle. So for example, the conference might be in June, submissions would then be due February 1st. They would spend somewhere around 2 months evaluating them, and you would get decisions at about 2 months prior to the conference. The paper doesn't come out if someone doesn't show up and present it. Officially, this means it gets vetted again at the conference stage. In practice, that doesn't actually happen. You get 20 minutes to present it. There's almost no discussion, if any. There are page limits, which in 2007 were still quite severe, but today, so for example, economics and computation has a 17-page limit, but it's in some minuscule font that my old eyes can't read, and the effect of that is that it turns out to 35 double-spaced pages. So not bad, and you can ask for an exception if you think you need more. Now they do have journals, and I'll get to that in a moment, so you have an alternate publication route. But for the conferences, part of the reason for limiting it is so that you can make decisions about them in the two-month period. The way that the conference papers are evaluated is there's a program committee that will be composed of typically two program chairs. The program chairs select a senior program committee, which is enough so that each paper gets two senior program committee reads. In addition, there will be program committee members, which are not called junior, even though as opposed to senior, I guess they would have to be. And there will be typically three of those. So a paper actually is read by at least five people in the field and evaluated. And one of the things I really like about this process is that it's online. So the program committee discuss the different flaws and they go back and forth. And if one says, this is to refer to David's model, if this is a blemish, the other says, I don't think that blemish matters, here's why. And you get that kind of discussion. If the discussion, so some of them converge quickly. I would say three quarters of them converge very quickly, but the marginal papers get a fair bit of discussion back and forth. Ultimately, it's the program chairs who make the determination, but they're informed by not just reports, but this whole interactive body. And if I wanted to, of discussion, and if I wanted to point to a single thing that would make the refereeing process a lot better, it would be that. Have the referees talk. And here's a tip for you. When you send back your report, your revision, always use a single document to say how you responded to the referees, because that not only does it tell the referees how you responded and remind them what they said, because it was a year ago and they've forgotten, it also lets each referee see what the other referee said. And that's a process that the editor should do but rarely does in practice. Okay, one thing that matters a lot here is travel. These conferences are all over the world, and as a result, one of the things that separates out, say, rich universities from poor universities is travel funds, and that's a place where, in fact, Microsoft and Google and other companies donate a fair bit of money. Facebook, not Apple. So don't use iPhones. So let me I got 2 minutes left. Let me evaluate. So one thing is there's less vetting. In the words of computer scientists, that's a feature, not a bug. We do too much vetting. Let's reduce the whole level by putting the time pressure on it. We actually get the vetting done more rapidly. It's very fast. Again, 4 months, and computer scientists for some reason don't write the paper until the night before the deadline. And so the whole process is idea to publication in 4 months. There's much lower expositional quality. So one of the things economists, when CS people read our papers, they say, wow, they're just a thing of beauty. Again, that's could be a bug, not a feature. The process favors different topics. Theory does better. Empirical work is harder. Because empirical work, you've got more challenges. And that was one of the things I thought no revisions helps on it's much easier to dream up blemishes for empirical work than it is for theory. There may be some discouraging of really deep ideas, and that's one of the things, but they do have journals. And then finally, another thing is there's almost no benefit to being a referee, but being on a program committee is viewed as being an important part of the profession. So as a result, there's a reward that we lack in the refereeing process to being on the program committee, because that's a much more visible, you're part of the community process. And so and because of the interactive nature, it becomes visible to more people. And with that, I'll shut up.
Okay, so I have the unenviable position of being the last person speaking, and I was hoping that I wouldn't overlap too much with what everybody else said, and there's only a little bit of overlap. I actually think there's a lot of good in the refereeing process. So I've been at this for a year and a half. My observation is most referees take the job extremely seriously and try really hard. That's been, by and large, well over 90%, maybe even over 95%. And most referees, as I will show you shortly, are very speedy. So that part has been nice. Now, error rates, and that, of course, is a very subjective concept, I don't think are high. I think we do have type 1 and type 2 errors, but after people have submitted to one or two journals, the good stuff gets in and the bad stuff doesn't, on average. I think it's not a terribly broken process. Average referee turnaround time, this is JFE. So this is JFE for the last 10 years, or not the last 5 years, then I got tired. And it's actually has gone down. The mean turnaround time for referees and for the editorial process at the JFE, that's usually only one or two more days, has gone down. So, and 35 over at the end in 2015 is in fact statistically significantly lower than 48. So it has been going down over time. There will always be low, slow people. There's nothing that one can do about that. If when I get a slow person there, I never use them again. But, you know, it's just bad. In 2015, and two-thirds of the papers were back in a month. So I thought that was quite nice. And nearly all in 3 months. So yes, there are some horror stories about papers taking forever, but most of them don't. And the process, I think, is getting better and faster, and I suspect that that is largely a culture change, which is a good thing. But it's something else, too. This is a histogram of the referee turnaround times, and as you can see, it's bunched at 28. So what's 28? 28 is the day after which we don't pay the fee. So the JFE is unique in that we pay our referees a lot. I think it went up to $350 on January 1st. And so people do, they really do take, it matters. You don't need to do any statistical tests there. What is interesting about this is that there are very few people who go out in the tails. And I think one of the other things that the JFE does that is unique that I think is a good idea is we publish with referee names average turnaround times. So there's annually we get to see who are the slow people. And I think that does give people some incentive to not be the person with the 295-day report that everybody sees. So I think that both of those things are useful incentives that keep the turnaround time low. But the process is not perfect, and nor will it ever be. This is a human endeavor, and human endeavors are by nature fraught with error. We will never, ever get rid of type 1 and type 2 errors. We will let garbage papers in no matter how hard we try, and we will sadly keep innovative papers that might have moved the field forward out no matter how hard we try. So I do think the profession has moved, however, towards trying to get, been worrying too much about those type 2 errors. I think we worry too much about the bad papers getting in, and of course the problem with that is that there's a size power trade-off. And so we end up with fewer innovative papers getting in at the same time. So what's wrong with this? Why has it happened? And what can we do? So I want to bring up an interesting point that I was talking to a junior colleague of mine who is not at my own institution. That makes him truly anonymous. Now you have no information on who this person is. And he said to me, he was talking about economics versus finance. He said, when people submit to economics journals, they submit early. They don't polish as much. How would I ever get tenure if I polished so much if I'm going to spend 3 years at the journal anyway? And I explained to him that was a terrible attitude, but then it also caused me to worry. And I said, why do you say people? Is this you or is this a cultural thing? And he seemed to think it was a cultural thing. And so I think the slow reviewing process does give people bad incentives. And so I think that it is useful, therefore, to be speedy. I think it gives authors more of an incentive to get it right the first time, as does the up and out option. And I also think there are too many referees. Now, this is from my own personal experience. Up until, 2000, I never had more than two referees. And even at economics journals, I occasionally only had one. Both of those were rejected, but that's okay. But I think this is often a large waste of refereeing resources, especially in light of the fact that the number of submissions has just utterly skyrocketed. And I think when you have, if you have a larger referee pool and you have more referees, you're just going to have more people spending less time on the individual. We have scarce resources. There aren't lots of referees out there who are willing to devote their time. And so I think this hurts the profession, and every paper is different. Some papers really only need one referee. Some need two or three or four. I think none ever need five. But I think that is one problem. There are scarce referees, and it's a serious burden on the profession. And I think the profession has moved towards more and more and more referees, and it's not obvious to me that that's a good thing. The other thing is I think that has happened is that I think it's true that too many cooks spoil the stew. And so what I have seen with papers over this, not just as an editor, but at my own papers, my colleagues' papers, is that the more referees there are, the paper becomes focused and sharp. And I think that the papers that are watered down and less focused, less sharp, move the field forward less. And so I think that all of this extra reviewing is not necessarily good, and I've seen that. And then I wanted to point out something that goes above and beyond what David was pointing out in his signal jamming paper. I think there is a signal jamming problem, but I also think that the number of referee requests has gone up because it's cheap. So there has been an extraordinary advance in the last 20 years in data and computing technology. We have access to data that we never had access to 20 years ago, and computation has become incredibly easy. Things that we utterly couldn't do 5 years ago are just like that. So people, referees ask it because they can. No referee has ever asked me to redo it, do 50 variations on an estimation when they know it's going to take, 6 months per estimation. And no one has ever asked my husband, the physicist, to spend another $10,000 of his grant to shoot that laser one more time. Because there aren't an extra $10,000 in the grant. So I think that is one of the main reasons that it has become cheap. And that's both a good thing and a bad thing. So I think solution just is giving referees guidance and incentives. So many of you probably got this because Miles Kimball is friends with everybody in the profession on Facebook. So he posted this. This was a referee request that he got from some journal that he did not say. It might have been one of you. I have no idea. It certainly wasn't me. So this is his referee request that he got. From personal experience, there is a growing tendency for referees to provide very long, detailed reports that sometimes read with slight exaggeration, like an essay on the question, how I would have written this paper. This is not always optimal. It costs the referees time, and it may result in a lengthy, non-converging referee process overall. Our main interest is in receiving advice on A, the overall significance of the findings and claims, and B, their technical correctness. In my experience, a relatively brief report containing a set of consecutively numbered paragraphs, each making one point, is most useful in reaching a final decision. I think that's right. I think most papers at this point in the profession that get submitted to journals usually, not always, have been vetted. They've been presented. The authors have polished them quite a bit. And so I think less and more pointed refereeing is a good thing. And I think if editors are very clear in stating what they want, this can happen. I'm going to skip the next slide because I put something on it I don't want. And I think the process is not broken. I think peer review is kind of like democracy. Both are terribly flawed, but try to find something better. So I do think that small tweaks in editorial behavior can go a long way. So I think that activists, editors is a good thing. That's what I've been doing anyway. And I think that giving guidance to referees is also a useful thing. That's all I have to say.
Great, thank you very much, Tony. So now we're going to have some panel discussions. I guess to start, I'd like to circle back to the paper by Ivo Welch that was mentioned earlier, where he found a surprisingly low correlation in the recommendations of referees, both for a leading finance conference and for leading economics and finance journals. And he found that referees seem to differ greatly both in their scales, that is their intrinsic generosity, and in their relative rankings of papers. So I'd like to pose to anyone on the panel, what does this say about the objectivity and accuracy of the review process, and is this an issue that can be addressed, or should it be addressed?
When I was an AER co-editor, we did that same study, and actually the initial round found the referees were uncorrelated. But I don't think that actually represented a fact, in the sense that when you looked at what the report said, there was much more agreement in the text of the reports than there was in the final recommendation about whether to ask for a revision or not. And so my experience was the referees would identify the same flaws. They might differ on whether those flaws were fixable. Well, not all the same flaws. There are a lot of different flaws as well. But that they would differ on whether those were fixable, and then they would differ also on the overall importance. But nonetheless, as guidance, the guidance was much more correlated than the checkbox would indicate.
Mm-hmm. Any other reactions? Penny.
To reinforce what Preston said, I personally take the text of the recommendation very seriously and completely ignore the checkbox. I'll give you two examples. One recommendation to the editor looks as follows. This is a great paper. The question is original and important, and I find the results convincing. That said, I'm not sure it's good enough for the AER. Reject. I completely ignore the recommendation. Vice versa, you often get a recommendation, this paper is seriously flawed. I don't understand why they submitted it to the AER. It's not original. There is nothing interesting about it. Revise and resubmit. I mean, these are true stories. I've gotten both of these recommendations. You can see why we completely ignore the checkboxes.
Great.
Can I say, also I do think, though, you know, there is randomness in this process, right? You know, you take the same paper and you try it again at a top journal. Some of the outcomes are going to be the same. And I always felt that some set of the papers I accepted, I knew everyone else would have made the same decision. And then there was a lot of things that were marginal cases, and they were right around the bottom of what we wanted to accept or reject, and some people would have accepted them and some would have rejected them. And you know, there is this sort of effect of the draws of your referees. Now, you know, in part that does get fixed these days with this sort of thing of you can sort of, you know, like a, as a theorist, you can send your paper to Theoretical Economics and to JED and to Games and Economic Behavior and to AEJ Micro. And in some sense you do get those multiple draws that resolve some of this, but it is true that each one, you know, there's unavoidably going to be some randomness there.
Right. So, sir, you're viewing it as basically we've reached the irreducible amount of randomness, which, from what Preston was saying a moment ago, that irreducible amount nearly pure noise? Although, maybe I should take it back, because there was the other point that it's not just the recommendations that matter, but yeah. The actual substance. Okay.
Let me say
yes.
One other thing. There isn't a whole lot of evidence about, and I think several speakers mentioned this, on how well this process really works. But one piece of evidence is, are there papers that ultimately are great that were rejected a lot? And Gans and Shepherd have a very, you know, a paper I quite recommend reading on this topic about great rejected papers, which, you know, Akerlof is sort of the poster child. But being rejected three times and with referees reports that are embarrassing for us as economists. But one thing that's true in that paper, I believe, at least my 20-year recollection is that half of the great rejected papers were rejected by Lord Keynes. So a single editor, and I think, you know, one thing that good editors matter, a single editor was responsible for half of them. So these are papers that ultimately become, you know, well-cited and important, but were rejected. And that's actually kind of might be worth actually revisiting and seeing whether that process is working better or worse than it was 20 years ago.
So is that suggesting that maybe active editing isn't that good after all? It's good when it works well, but it can work very badly too?
Oh, I think that's, so clearly that's true, but I think it also is better than the alternative of a machine could just check the boxes. Mm-hmm. Because the editor is the person who sees lots of papers, has a much better sense of kind of what the quality standards are for the journal. And also there's this a bias that no one's mentioned is people both have high standards about their own area, but they also like their own area. And so they'll think what looks like a marginal contribution from an outsider's perspective is important because it was hard in their area. And so I think that's one of the things that an editor relative to referees brings to the process. And so you really wouldn't want to take the editor out of the process. Mm-hmm. And hence active almost tautologically then becomes better than mm-hmm. checkbox reader.
Mm-hmm. I guess on the noise, just going back to the noise part that Glenn was mentioning, that some of it is irreducible, it reminds me of the story of the judge, and he found some people guilty who were actually innocent. He found some that found some innocent that were actually guilty. So on average, justice was done. So I guess going on to another question, recent studies in social psychology and economics have found a low rate of replicability of study of papers published in top journals. Given this, should we still be claiming that economics is a science?
Okay,
I think
so,
we have a taker.
I have a lot to say about this. So as a starter, the issue of replicability is much more pronounced in the sciences. This is where papers get routinely retracted from Nature and Science. So journals that we hold to be our role models, the issue of replicability shows up there much more frequently than it does in social sciences. Number two, one issue with all these studies is they've never been replicated themselves. So, the paper that you're referring to appeared on the blogs claiming we cannot replicate all these papers in economics. I actually contacted the authors. I said, can you tell me precisely which papers you couldn't replicate at the AER? They, for good reasons, they didn't give the names, but I actually studied all the references and I figured out which three they couldn't replicate. And in all three cases, there was a good reason for that. There was some proprietary software involved, which they should have stated. But my point is that many of these claims are made for sensational reasons, and it's not clear to me that we do have a problem. I think there is a big challenge out there, which is more and more papers use confidential data. For good reasons, we've discussed extensively at the AER and the American Economic Association more generally how we should deal with these papers, because some of the most interesting research these days relies on data, on confidential data, either administrative data or data from private companies. So one extreme approach would be to say we only publish papers where we can actually replicate everything, which would shut off 90% of interesting research. Or we can do what we do now, which is we do the best we can with the procedures we have, and we leave the rest to the market with the idea that if the question is interesting enough, people are going to go after it, and they're going to try to replicate, and if there is a problem, they will figure it out. And when all these cases break out, let's take the recently publicized case in political science where the data was fabricated. This is the worst case you can imagine. The positive side of this story is it did come out after a few months, and it came out precisely because the paper was published, so people knew about it in the journal. It spurred further research, and the problem was was identified right away. So I take issue with this notion that we have a huge problem in the social sciences that exists only in economics or maybe political science and not elsewhere.
I don't see this as a big problem. I think many papers we write are not that important and turn out not to be that important, but the ones that are important topics, people will try to not replicate them not only with their own data, but with other data sets, other industries, other countries, other time periods. And I think it's healthy to have journals say something and then people explore the same question in other contexts and have debate back and forth. And I just don't see any problem with that debate playing out in the journals where Journal A says this, and then this article says this, and this article says this, and we learn about the important things, and the ones that are not important, no one replicates them, then did it really matter that no one's replicated or that it's hard to replicate?
Do you think that there's any issue, though, of how much of this replicability is going on? So clearly it will be the most important papers that are subject to the most checking, but still there's a question of where to put that cutoff. Is there any reason to think that we're close to the right cutoff? I was also wondering with respect to the sciences where they get these non-replications that you were mentioning, Penny, and I don't know the answer, but I'm just wondering, are they having a severe problem of non-replications because they're actually trying to replicate, and those efforts to replicate then get published, whereas in economics and finance, it's relatively seldom that one can publish a replication or a pure attempt at a replication. So I'm saying things I don't know the answer, so I'm just raising it in case there's interest.
So I think in science it's different because you have competing labs, and a replication isn't going to the same machine in the same lab. It's using your own machine and your own lab, and so it's creating independent data that's trying to replicate. So it really is a genuine independent replication. And we're not a purely experimental, field experiments have grown, but we're not an experimental science. And so replication actually means something very different in social sciences than it does in the sciences.
So I can give you one example of the kind of replication that Tony's talking about. So recently we published actually two papers by Raj Chetty and co-authors on value added of teachers. As you can imagine, the topic is hot and important. There are already two replication studies. They cannot use the same data because the data is administrative. They have no access to it, but they've used very similar data from other states. And so this is the kind of replication that goes on in the sciences all the time. You go after the same question, the same conclusions with your own data, but it's a very important exercise, and the results do get published, the results of these exercises. I see less value in trying to find exactly the same data set that you got from some private company and match every single variable if the question is not that important. That said, I will make one qualification. I think, so at the AER, we have this policy of replicating all the results for the papers for which we receive the data and the code. So we have an editorial assistant replicate everything at the time of acceptance. I found this actually to be a huge service to the authors more than anyone else. Because at the time of submission, you are, as you probably all know, you are sick and tired of the paper. You've gone through 10 reviews, review rounds. You just don't want to see the data anymore. So you are very tempted to just put everything aside and do something else. And then a year later, someone asks you for something and you don't know where it is. And I think the current policy forces people to document what they've done, to clean it up, you know, to provide it to the journal if it's available for posting. I think this is a huge service to the authors, and I think that's a good thing that we do that. And again, with confidential data, unfortunately, we cannot do it, and that's the cost.
Mm-hmm. So, changing gears, a different aspect of active editing. What do you think of the extent to which editors and referees should follow their own beliefs in making decisions or making recommendations, as compared with following conventions or publishing approaches that are popular, even if one disagrees with them?
I guess the answer is that people should just tell you what they think. From a referee standpoint, I don't want you to just kind of start guessing what other people might like or what, you know, the profession might like. You know, the only reason I consult with you is to kind of get sort of your own idiosyncratic sort of beliefs. And sort of I view my job as an editor to kind of figure out where you're coming from, how biased you might be in your relationship to the discipline, to the methodology, to the author, and try to adjust kind of your own thinking based on what I think is right. And from the editor perspective, so I guess Penny can speak, she's picking co-editors, so she should speak about that. But I think one reason sort of people pick co-editors is they want them to kind of apply their own judgment. Otherwise, you take a machine and make him sort of, you know, aggregate referees. So I completely use my own judgment and my own taste kind of when I decide about papers, trying to kind of weigh different things. But it's not that I'm a machine and I'm trying to kind of pretend to be objective. I have clear ideas what, in my view, is like good research versus what might be kind of not so good research, and what should be published versus what should not be published. And for sure, that's kind of a big input into decisions. It's not completely orthogonal from everything I hear, but it's completely not. I can totally see that other people would make different decisions using the same input. So I think that's part of our job in some sense. So.
Mm-hmm. One slight thing. I mean, I think on the advice to referees side of it, I think referees should tell the editor both. I think the referee should say, people like that, you know, this is a hot topic, people like this, most people like it, I don't think it's that important. I mean, so I think, you know, if you're trying to get expertise from the referee, if they know both whether the most people would like it and whether they like it, tell the editor both. And then, yeah, on the editor side, I think the editors should do what they think, not what the profession thinks.
Mm-hmm. So let me add to that. my perspective was that we have fads that go on and that are really hot, and people are really excited about things, which on average, when it's really hot, it's probably overestimated in its importance, and so an editor can reasonably reduce that. And if it's your own fad, try to get advice from someone who's not a participant in the fad, so that you get a better perspective.
Well, I know in my case, if it's my own fad, then I'm going to think that the people who disagree with my fad are very foolish, and so it's harder for me to get advice because I'm trying to find non-fools. One example I had in mind was the behavioral versus rationalist kind of split, where it seems that you can have coexistence sometimes of competing research streams that strongly disagree with each other, and then the members of one stream think that the others are doing something that's deeply mistaken, and vice versa. And so then if the top editor of a major general interest journal were to believe strongly in one of those sides, I'm wondering, would it be appropriate to simply say, well, I'm rejecting everybody on the other side because that's just my genuine point of view? Laron, you seem maybe to be pretty close to that in the sense that you're suggesting follow your heart and follow your reason.
Well, I guess if I was running a journal, I wouldn't pick an editor who is too close to an extreme on one side or the other that might be at risk of having a policy of, like, I'm rejecting any rational papers or any behavioral papers. I think you try to pick editors who are reasonably balanced, so you think that, you know, even though they might be following their own judgment, they are less likely to kind of come up with some sort of, you know, very extremist type of policies, which I think to the most part that's the case. So I'm not that worried about it, but could it be if you pick the wrong editors? Yes, but I think are many of those exist? I don't think so. So I'm not that worried about it.
So I think with respect to this question, that perhaps the AER and Econometrica are a little different because we are supposed to be the official journals of the American Economic Association and the Econometric Society. And so when you assume the editorial position, you're supposed to be publishing the best paper in economics, not just the best papers in your area. So I think, you know, when you're appointed editor, you're appointed with this expectation that no matter what your tastes are, and we all have our very strong taste, you are going to also be able to rise above your taste and see the other side. So personally, I can tell you that when I get a paper, I try to assign it to the co-editor who's going to be most friendly to the paper. I think most editors are like that. We are not trying to kill papers. We are trying to give the paper a fair chance. And if the people who should be, in principle, be positively predisposed to these ideas do not think there is much there, then I accept the judgment.
So, David, you've brought up a really good example in behavioral versus rationalist, because that goes back at least 140 years, and it's a pendulum that swung back and forth. I entered the profession at the time when the pendulum was all the way out there on the behavioral side under what was known as Keynesian economics. And then swung back with the Lucas critique and so on. This is, I think, will continue to swing. Right now, behavioral is back, you know, it's back to 1970, say, and we're just reliving that. I look at that as being a train wreck in some sense, because you know it's going to swing back the other way. By the way, it's from a research strategy, if you're young enough, it's a good thing to get in front of. But it's this predictable. I mean, it's the hog cycles for economics.
Right. Well, so you're I mean, there's always the question of knowing when that turning point is going to happen, right? Or you can get run over by the train as well, even if it's a fad. I'd like to turn back also to the fact that there are different models in different fields, which Preston, you emphasized a great deal. But I want to raise for anyone, do we in economics have the best model? And if so, should other areas be switching to our model and be taking much, much longer to review papers? Or are there models in other fields that perhaps we should be adopting? Or is it that there's optimal heterogeneity between the fields?
First, you know, when Preston was talking, I was dying to interject that the grass is always greener on the other side. And I'm sure if we were attending a conference in computer science, they would be complaining about a bunch of things. I actually know the field quite a bit, and They have their own challenges. So I think every field has its problems. That said, I think I personally find it very productive to examine our procedures and ask the question you just asked. You know, is that the optimal way to do things? I do think there is optimal heterogeneity because the research, fundamentally the research we do in economics is very different from research in computer science or in the sciences. That said, you know, in recent years with this emergence of big projects that are conducted by teams, you know, the use of big data, the experiments, in some sense, empirical economics is becoming more and more like the sciences. So I think it helps to look at the sciences for alternative models. But I will emphasize one difference, which I think is quite important. If you make a mistake in computer science or even in the sciences, and you do it in your private lab, and you know that your project is relatively confined, yes, it's a blow to science if you have made a mistake. But in economics, you know, if we publish a paper on the minimum wage, and the conclusion is, you know, raising the minimum wage is going to have good effects or bad effects, I don't take a position, right? The next day, you know, this is going to be in the New York Times and on Wall Street Journal, and policy is going to be based on it in the very short term. And that puts a completely different, calls for different criteria for judging work, especially policy-relevant work in economics.
So do you think that there should be much stronger vetting of policy papers than papers that are basic science that do not have very direct, immediate implications?
So again, de facto, this is happening. So, you know, one view is that markets work in economics. So in those fields where that have very strong policy recommendations, people replicate and they replicate fast, and they're vigilant about it. And you know, that there is a good reason for that. These papers, by the way, they also have quick turnaround precisely because they're relevant. You know, they appear fast, they get replicated fast. On the other hand, you know, if you have a more theoretical paper, you can afford to take more time, I think. So I think even within economics, there is an optimal degree of heterogeneity, and there is no reason that we should treat all papers exactly the same.
So many schools use the heuristic of counting publications for tenure decisions, and because in economics and finance, publications are relatively long and elaborate and go through many revisions compared to many fields, that increases sampling error, because early in people's careers, that means that they have fewer opportunities or fewer tries for publishing in the top journals. So in terms of human capital sorting, would we be better off to have journals that view more streamlined papers as acceptable so that papers can be written and evaluated more quickly?
Yes.
I asked a leading question, didn't I? Okay, so that really triggered a very interesting exchange. I'm quite pleased about. And so what about data availability policy? So there's a fair amount of controversy about whether authors should be required to make their data publicly available, which has some advantages. And on the other hand, there's the issue of giving people incentives to generate data sets. So any reactions?
Actually, let me put a... So I have a couple of things to say about that. One is, we do research with census data, which is never going to be made publicly available because it violates people's privacy incredibly, and yet you want to have that available. Yahoo's policy, which I wrote on data availability, was an exact copy of the census. That was where I got it. That's a perfectly sensible policy. The idea that you're going to say, we're going to not publish any research that doesn't have a data set that's made publicly available is insane. It costs way too much for the benefits. The way the census works is you have to go be physically in the census so that they can secure the data and make sure that you don't take out, you know, Glenn's social security number from that database. There's nothing wrong with that. I can do the same thing. Now, not everybody is going to be able to get inside the census, but many will. This is the way Yahoo's policy works. Many other companies work in a similar way. Microsoft, we have lots of visitors to Microsoft Research, you come and have access to data that's within Microsoft. And sure, it comes with various NDAs, but that doesn't block publication. So I think a lot of this has been really overstated, and I want to go back to the policies that we use for census access are also what are used in many other corporate environments.
Any other reactions?
I guess two things. One, just to echo, Penny kind of touched on it, you know, before, on the lots of research is done now kind of with semi-confidential or fully confidential data, and I don't think we want to block this from publication, so we just need to do the best we can given the constraints. But the other point, you mentioned the word incentive there, as if, you know, if we are going to force everybody to post their data set, then people would have incentives to not kind of go collect data. Maybe I'm naive, but I just don't think that's like a first order concern. I think if you have a data set and you write the first paper first, you know, hopefully the first paper you write on the data is the best paper you can write with the data. So you already got like one paper advantage over anyone else who can use this data. And second, sort of, you already had like, you know, 1-2 years experience with the data. That's a huge kind of, you know, leap on anyone else who tries to start. It's not that you get the data and know which regression to run and you publish it. I mean, it takes a while to kind of familiarize yourself with what's going on in the data, what's good about it, what's bad about it, what's robust, what's not. So any 2-year kind of lead on anyone is a huge kind of advantage. So I think that by itself is big enough incentive to go collect more data. And if you took 2-3 years with the data and couldn't write the best paper you can, and that forces you to let other people try, that's a good thing for the profession too. So I just don't worry too much about the incentives aspect of this at all. So maybe I'm too naive, but I just don't see it as a problem.
Yeah, I would take the opposite view of your question, and I would say that actually, you know, I take Penny's point that we're doing authors a service sometimes in requiring them to document what they did and make their data available. And I think that, you know, if you want your work to be widely cited, one of the best things to do is to post the data on the web and make it very easy for people to use, and have people write 100 different variants on your paper would be almost the ideal thing. And that, you know, it's almost like it probably was an opportunity that authors were missing, that they hadn't realized that if you put your data up on the web, you actually become more famous than if you don't. Yeah.
So I just wanted to say one thing. I think there are two issues. There's data and there's code. And I think that there's no way that some data will ever be publicly available. There's nothing we can do about that, and that's fine. I think having authors make their code available should be absolutely compulsory. And that's true in economics. It's not true in finance yet.
So that's what I thought, but I have to say, so with respect to this topic, I've heard every view. And one view I heard actually yesterday was that providing code also infringes on intellectual property, because some people actually write big programs where one of the main contributions of the project is the code itself. So actually forcing them to provide the code, you know, opens the possibility for other people to free write on their work.
So let me give an analogy. Suppose I write a theory paper and I say I'm making use of a confidential lemma. So my proof follows from the confidential lemma, but unfortunately I can't share it with you because I'm going to need it for other papers that I'm going to write. Now in theory papers that would never get published. So is there a reason why empirical should be different?
Yes. So my group used the Twitter data a lot. You can go buy access, anybody in the room can go buy access to the Twitter data, but it's very expensive. There's no mechanism by which I can pay Twitter enough and make that data available. This period. I mean, you'd be talking billions of dollars would be what Twitter would expect. So, but should you stop using research with Twitter data? No, that would be my position. So yes, that's a big difference that somebody's selling the confidential lemma that I want to use.
Mm-hmm. Well, yeah.
And they own it. I wish they didn't. Actually, this is a big issue in finance because there are all these algorithms that are proprietary to companies, and we as outsiders to those companies just don't know how they work. They presumably know some stuff, at least they make money on it, that we don't know. It'd be really nice to have that in the public domain, but it isn't.
Mm-hmm. But again, so I find these issues are often not black and white. I mean, one issue I have with this is, suppose you get a paper where the contribution is documenting a novel fact, and it's a really interesting fact. but the data is confidential. So if the paper is just about this fact, personally I would be inclined to reject it, because if that's your contribution, I should be able to actually verify this fact. Now, in most cases where people use confidential data, they do much more than documenting facts. So you sort of take their word for the facts and then they do much more, and that's the justification for publishing them. But if it's just a fact, I would find David's argument quite compelling that how do I verify it?
And so for code, which is written by the author, so it's not something that literally cannot be disclosed, then is that a case where it's entirely sensible for journals to require its disclosure?
So we always require disclosure, even with confidential data. So the exception, again, is census data, because sometimes the authors have to sign an agreement that they cannot even disclose the code. Mm-hmm. But in general, we do ask for the code.
Mm-hmm. Let me just add, it's kind of related to what Penny said before, but just posting even if you have confidential data, just posting the code is already kind of a self-service for you a little bit, because it disciplines you to have a code that actually works on your own data. Nobody else can run the code at all, but just the fact that you have to post the code, you kind of try it out on your own data and make sure that actually you can replicate the results you publish. So that's by itself is a disciplinary kind of, even if like almost zero chance that anyone else could be able to run this code, that helps kind of clean up mistakes or stuff that happened in the last round that you forgot about and things like that. The other thing, just Penny, on one thing Penny said about the fact based on, just one fact that's based on conditional data, if there is like a fact that conditional verification would be publishable, but because it's confidential data, we cannot verify it, and then that's why we are worried about public, we can find, again, we can go out of the box and come up with a process that allow kind of, you know, anonymous third parties verify this fact by providing, you know, specialized access. So, you know, if that's important enough, we can come up with ways. We are basically in a process where we operate under constraints, and we need to do the best we can given the constraints. I mean, and if we can weaken the constraints, great, but sort of, you know, we just do the best we can based on whatever different circumstances exist.
Yeah, actually, so one concern that emerged after last summer because of the political science case is that you have cases of pure fraud where people have fabricated everything. So someone proposed that there is some type of audit service where you go, even with confidential data, someone verifies that if you run your code on your data, at least you get the results you get. So something like that, I think it's a sad day for social science that we have to think about these eventualities. I mean, I do believe that people make mistakes. I even believe that, you know, people sometimes when the results conform to their priors, they don't look very hard for reasons to take them down, but until this happened, I never thought that someone would be capable of going that far, of totally fabricating data. And the fact that this happened, I think, sent shockwaves through social sciences, but still I would like to think that this is a very isolated case.
Great. So before we turn to Q&A, I just thought I would check whether there's anything further any of you would like to say. Okay, so we will now take questions from the floor. Yes.
So you've touched on this a little bit, but I haven't correctly addressed it, which is the issue of publication bias in the field of science. Does the refereeing process there play a role, or does this all just fall into the area of the critical analysis? Or is it not an issue?
Could you repeat the last few words you said? I didn't hear them. So could you define publication bias?
Publication bias is sort of the self-confirming studies that basically report what we would expect are discarded. Those that give you something surprising, sexy, are overblown, but then if you look at the consensus of what has been published, well, it's not actually, it's more a little sexy stuff, not really informing us about the subject matter that we want to study.
Mm-hmm. Any takers?
I think actually if you look at the responses of referees or what papers get published, papers that yield a novel or unexpected result are more likely to get published. You very often get the response, well, I already knew that, and it's very much consistent with the existing literature. Why publish that again? So I think novelty or getting something unexpected does get rewarded. I think what sometimes people refer to as publication bias is you try to find an effect and you don't find anything. So it's not that it doesn't conform to expectations, is you just invested a lot of time in gathering the data, in writing the code, and in the end your standard errors are very large, and or you just don't find an effect you expected, there is nothing to report. The fact is these papers don't get published, that's true. And so the AA has tried to partly address that, very incompletely, but I think it's a step in the right direction, is by establishing this registry, at least for randomized controlled trials, where people register their intention to undertake certain studies and eventually also report the results. And the advantage of this is you get to report also the non-existence of results. If nothing comes, if you don't get anything, this is actually reported there, but not in a journal.
Right, and I guess I would reiterate the exceeding importance of this issue that people are running many, many studies, and then the ones that come out significant are the ones that get published in journals. And so you get this selection bias problem. Now there's more and more systematic research about this problem. So for example, Cam Harvey has been, and co-authors have been writing papers about the trying to quantify how much do we need to adjust standards for statistical significance before we view something as significant, taking into account the fact that there are numerous papers sitting in desk drawers that did not come out significant, and that we have this selection bias that we're not seeing those papers being submitted or being published. But I would agree that there are other biases in the publication process. So if a result is really cute or engaging, then it grabs interest, and maybe such papers get the benefit of the doubt. So certainly when I'm reading social psychology papers and the result just seems like I really wish that were true because it's so interesting, then I become immediately a little bit doubtful of wondering whether the result is bogus or not. So there's a problem.
I think the problem that underlies this bias problem is that nobody wants to read studies that replicate other studies. That is, if the message of a study, which is really valuable for science, is we studied this using new data from a different perspective, and what we found was consistent with what was already believed to be true, nobody reads that paper. And if we can't solve that problem, that we don't consume the papers, then you can't really expect the editors to say, well, I'm going to publish papers for the good of science, even though nobody wants to read them. And I think that's the nature of the problem. Maybe if we had an archive, although then you still have, can you get promoted on the basis of papers that nobody wants to read? By the way, it's really easy to write other kinds of papers that nobody wants to read.
It's cheaper, right? We can produce those at low cost. But Preston, what you're saying seems to be a different angle from what some of the panelists were saying before, that if a paper is important or timely, it's going to get replicated really, really soon. And there's a whole lot of checking on this. So I'm trying to get people to maybe react to each other on that.
Well, I think that, so to opine on that slightly, that when somebody comes out with something like the minimum wage doesn't affect the quantity, or it's worse still, the demand is increasing in the wage, that gets lots of replication attempts immediately. But that's the case where people didn't believe it, or many didn't believe it. It's when the paper says something that, yes, that's actually quite plausible, it would be helpful to replicate it because it was only one data and it would data set. But now the returns to that aren't very high. That I think that's the case. And it's impossible to get those published in major journals, if that's what you find. Now, you could go on the fishing expedition, hope you find that it's not replicated, so that you could, you have some a message to say. But that's where I think the individual incentives don't align with the social incentives.
So one place where I think we do see replications is if somebody writes an important paper with a result that people find interesting, other authors will, in other countries, other industries, go off and replicate the, replicate it. So they'll see if these results are robust in different contexts. And in that sense, I think that those papers may not get published in the very top journals, but they will get published. And I think that in that sense, we do see quite a bit of replication effort in economics and finance.
Other questions? Yes.
Okay. So in principle, we have comments that do exactly that. So you submit a comment, you know, showing that you cannot replicate a study that was already published. Let me give you the honest answer. I would have given the student the same advice, especially because it was a student. If it's someone more mature, I would say go for it. I think, honestly, there is a cost to doing that. You become famous, but there's a cost.
I would just jump in that there's also a benefit. One can become quite famous knocking down something that's important enough. So it depends on risk aversion, I guess. Other question, yes. That's you, yes, don't turn around. Come with us.
This is the single best feature of the way computer scientists make these decisions, is that they actually do it online. It's asynchronous, but it's a chat. It has the effect of chat. Now, they don't include the authors very much. So that is to say, the referees talk among each other. They come to a consensus that goes back to the author. For about half the conferences, the author gets one shot at responding to those, usually with a line, a word limit. And they can respond, and the referees then do one more round and make that determination. That interactiveness is really important, because some referees will have noticed something that changes the opinion of the other referees. And that discussion also of, is this important in the grand scheme of things? And then actually a role I have in the CS literature is to say, yeah, that was in a paper by Roger Meyerson, you know, 30 years ago. And so that there are things that are being rediscovered all the time that they're less aware of. And that putting people together helps solve that problem. I think it would be a great thing to experiment with in econ journals.
So I'm a big believer at kind of case by case. I'm not sure that sort of we want to impose this is the process, we should always do this or that. It depends on the context and what you see in the first round and so forth. But just to give you two examples, that stuff that I did in Econometrica over the last 2 years, once I got kind of, you know, a fairly wide range of recommendation from referees, kind of about one paper, and I just got the most extreme that happened to be knowing each other and I know them. on the phone, and we had like a three-way conversation without the author, but still to kind of, okay, you said kind of definitely accept this, you said definitely reject. You guys are typically kind of more consistent with each other. Let's get on the phone and think what's going on, what's good about it, what's bad about it. And the conversation helps to kind of smooth things out and find kind of a sweet spot in the middle. The other one that I did now three times maybe in 2 years is that, you know, instead of going through a full round of revision, it's a little bit like a conversational thing of basically asking the author, here are the reports, here are like what I'm thinking. You know, why don't you send me like a four-page memo of what you think about this kind of, and I'll run it by the referees and go from there. And I think other people do it in other places. So I don't think we want to do it every single time or too often because it's imposing too much tax on staff. But when there's a chance that of miscommunication or the people are thinking this is completely wrong, but there might be a chance that actually there's a simple answer to that, or having something in between a full revision versus kind of, you know, just a short conversation that with some formality in it can kind of speed up and make things much more efficient and remove a lot of the cost of getting people to write a full new paper just to realize that something else is missing. So I think that, like, this is for sure something we should use. How often and when, I think that's sort of up for grabs, but it depends.
Okay, and with that thought, we close the session, and I very much want to thank this panel for such an incisive discussion. Thank you very much.